This is a message to every member of law enforcement and the military. I'm sure you know that there are laws in the works right now that would effectively end the Second Amendment as we know it in the United States. If you signed up for duty for honorable reasons, and if you made your oath to the Constitution in good faith, then we shouldn't have to convince you that this is wrong. We shouldn't need to convince you of just how dangerous this is or where this is headed. Deep inside, you know exactly where this is going, and you know that you have a choice to make. At this juncture in history, there can be no question that those holding the reins of power in Congress, in the Senate, and in the executive branch no longer represent the rule of law. By destroying the Constitution with the Patriot Act and the NDAA and numerous other police state measures, they have abandoned every shred of legitimacy and have made themselves into enemies of the people. They have become a criminal syndicate in the fullest sense of the word, and now they're about to take it to the next level. You took an oath to defend the Constitution from all enemies, foreign and domestic. The Congress, the Senate, and the executive branch have made themselves into a domestic enemy, and they are going to attempt to use you to help them. It's time to choose which side of history you're going to be on. If you're going to make your stand, the time is now. If you wait until the law-abiding citizens of America have been disarmed, then there will be no one left to stand by your side down the line. Any congressperson or senator who puts their name to any law which infringes upon the right to bear arms should be arrested for treason. That would be a literal fulfillment of your oath. If you don't want the situation to come to that, then on behalf of millions of honest, law-abiding gun owners in America who would sincerely prefer not to see America slide into a bloody civil war, I ask you to send a letter to every congressperson, senator, and state lawmaker. A letter not asking them nicely to abide by the Constitution, but letting them know, on no uncertain terms, what will happen if they don't. Make it clear to them that not only will you refuse to enforce their edicts, but that they will be defining themselves as enemies of the Constitution and of the people if they go down this road. Make them understand that you will hold them personally responsible for their signature, and that they will pay the consequences for their actions. If you feel as strongly as I do that this message needs to get to every man and woman in uniform, then please share it with every person that you know, police officer, soldier, and civilian alike. Please look up the email addresses of your local sheriff and police forces and send them a link to this video. Please post this on police and military forums. Post it on Facebook in police, military, and Second Amendment-oriented groups and pages. Post it to Twitter and send it to influential bloggers and media figures. Spread it far and wide and keep spreading it until the Congress and the Senate get the message and tuck their tails between their legs in response. The criminals running the United States are nothing without the enforcement arm, and they know it. You know you're dealing with a fundamental concept when it's difficult to define a word without using one of its synonyms. The strange thing about rights is that though we usually think of them in a positive sense, in reality, rights are comprised of boundaries. Freedom of speech, for example, cannot exist unless boundaries are established which prevent those in power from murdering or imprisoning those who speak out against them. But who is ultimately responsible for upholding those boundaries? You might think that you have the right to your beliefs and to speak your mind, but what happens to those rights when a gang of armed men start moving from house to house killing or kidnapping those that hold beliefs that they don't agree with. This is a scenario that's unfolded over and over again throughout history. It keeps repeating, not because history has been forgotten, but rather because it hasn't been properly understood. That which we most need to understand often hides behind questions that we don't want to answer. Do those who are being attacked have the right to defend themselves? Do they have the right to the means to defend themselves? Or should they just put their faith in the government? There are those who believe that the government should have the monopoly on violence, that the government should be the only one armed, and that we should trust the government to protect us. There's just one little tiny problem with that position. The gang of armed men doing the killing and the kidnapping usually is the government. It's the governments of the world who have initiated the genocides, the ethnic cleansings, the great mass murders. It's the governments who have systematically exterminated political dissidents. It's the governments who have built the concentration camps and the secret prisons. It's the governments who have always been behind the worst crimes committed against humanity. Human governments have repeatedly demonstrated themselves to be the most bloodthirsty, ruthless, and corrupt organizations on this planet. Even the sickest serial killers have nothing on the state. And yet some would entrust them with the absolute power of life and death over you and your family. That's what's at stake when you give the government the monopoly on violence. Because when the people have no means of defense, the government has no boundaries. Some would sidestep this issue by asserting that what we need is a stronger United Nations, a global government that's capable of keeping the rest of the world in line. But this just underscores a deep misconception. Government attracts tyrants, petty dictators, bullies, and psychopaths like manure draws flies. It always has, and it always will. And the more power associated with the position, the greater the attraction. Government attracts these types of individuals because it gives them an opportunity to exert power over other people. And for icing on the cake, they get a paycheck. What more could a psychopath ask for? Global government is the ultimate power, the power to run the world. You can rest assured that the crazies will find their way in. And sooner or later, they'll be running it. Then who will protect you? Then who will you turn to? You can't resolve this issue by creating bigger and bigger governmental bodies. You can't buy safety by giving more and more of your power and rights away. The root of the issue is the monopoly on violence. And the solution is simple. No one should be given the monopoly on violence. Humans simply aren't mature enough to deal with that kind of temptation. A counterbalance must be maintained. And the right to self-defense is that counterbalance. The right to defense is the boundary which makes all other rights possible. And it's not just a right, it's a responsibility. We are responsible for protecting our families and our communities. And we don't eliminate that responsibility when we hand it over to someone else. But the right to defense is meaningless without the means of defense. Therefore, the right to own and carry the means of defense is a core human right. As bitter of a pill as that might be for some people, what you need to realize is that if you allow that right to be taken from you when you don't need it, it won't be there when you do.